wait for the cue here. You let us know.
All right.
I'm John Stine. This is my friend Oita Coleman, and we're both with the Open Voice Network. I'm former Intel and Cisco. Oita, former SAS.
Former SAS, yeah, in the analytics AI, responsible for software quality.
And this is what we are, and we're going to talk about why this would be important in our conversations. We are Open Source Community Linux Foundation. We are focused on conversational AI from a standards, openness, interoperability, privacy, all those perspectives. We are not going to be, let me make it clear, we're not going to be a platform, but we are looking toward the future of conversational AI, especially from a user's perspective. Especially from an American Express perspective, especially from those enterprises, NGOs, and organizations that are part of, get away from the speaker, of what you're working on from an IoTG perspective. If you've got the vision part, this is the voice part, you know, AI, ML, et cetera. Our sponsors are these, you know, Microsoft, Deutsche Telekom, Target Corporation, Schwartz Group, Veritone. Founding principles of what we do are about data protection, openness, and interoperability. Those are the three major reasons why we were formed really 2 years ago. In fact, we just celebrated our second birthday. So we're young, we're growing, you know, we're making progress. Very exciting. Our theme, bring user trust. And user trust, really from several perspectives. When you say user trust, most people say, oh, it's about privacy, right? It's about data protection. But this is also about the trust of enterprises, such as yours. How is voice used to create value? Where is it used to create value? How will it be used to create value in the future? What can we trust about this technology from a user's perspective? And again, for it to create value and sustain value. Some things, click it if you would, please. This is our understanding, and here's a key point about what we're up to. This is our understanding of the market. Right, Intel, we're gonna think about TAM, right? Most individuals would say the voice market is that of the general purpose platforms, Siri, Alexa, Google, and yes, they've done a great job. And generally, with Google getting out of the third party app market, Google Home, roughly around 300,000 apps, give or take, worldwide. US is roughly 35 to 40% of that, as we know. However, and again, we all know this, and yet, all too often, we don't think, how big could this get? How big will it get? Especially as we think we're looking at, over the next several years, the Michelangelo moment. Think of the Sistine Chapel. You've got the, you know, one finger coming this way. General purpose apps need third-party enterprise users, enterprise value. They need to connect to an American Express. They need to connect to Target. They need to connect to whomever, Bank of America. On the other side, Target, Bank of America, American Express need and want to connect to those constituents of the general purpose platforms. That's going to come together. You know, people in the voice industry are saying, oh my goodness, Google got out of the third-party app business. What's going to happen to third-party apps? What's going to happen to third-party third parties exist. They're running IVRs. They're running connections for voice that are going to their constituents, but they're unwilling to give away their data. Key point, they're unwilling to give away their data. They're unwilling to put themselves at the mercy of those who are unwilling to respect the data. The total available market here is in billions. I've reached out to Tom and to others at Intel. This is a billion destinations market. There's no reason why NVIDIA should be leading in this and Intel not. In the car, in the smart home, enterprise apps anticipated growing 20 to 30% this year based upon a number of third-party analyst firms. The fastest growing element within voice are enterprise inside their firewall. Some call them IVR, some call them customer assistance, some call them whatever. I'd love to learn what you're doing. But this is the fastest growing area in voice right now. It's not part of this ecosystem. We lose sight of it because it's not in this whole generate area of publicity and comment. Fastest growing, every website will be voice enabled. We will reach and will operate within a worldwide voice web. 1.9 billion websites online, IoT endpoints, IoTG, everywhere. Billions of destinations, as you know. We will reach them via voice. We will interact with them via voice. Every AI will be conversational, say the futurists. And then, of course, in the metaverse, God knows how we define that. Come on up front. We're just talking here. We're friends. However we define the metaverse, you know, the immersive world will be largely voice-driven. Certainly immersive gaming and other places, of course we'll touch, tap, swipe. Of course we'll do this. But voice will increasingly be the interaction for the metaverse. This is the world that's in front of us with voice. Now, some people would say, well, this is not growing fast. You know, voice is at the low end of the hype curve. There's no reason to invest. You buy on the dip. This is growing and ready, poised, starting with this, is poised to grow rapidly. And again, we're growing toward that Michelangelo moment. Oh, wait, if you would, please. This is why our work is important to you. We have six major work groups, more than 220 volunteers across 13 nations. It's not just theory. We are actively building and doing right now, and the core of that is a vision for interoperability. How does an application, an agent on a Google platform, talk to a Mycroft platform, talk to a Deutsche Telekom platform, talk to a Baidu platform, talk to a Microsoft Azure AI platform, talk to Alexa, talk to Siri? We have the outline of how that will work. There will be multiple layers. These are the key four, but there's going to be N different layers of which we will have protocols and specifications to allow the sharing of data, messages, acoustic, context, controls, and then on and on and on, depending upon the development environment, depending upon what you need to achieve, depending upon the relationship between your platform and someone else's. And we'll be in a host-delegate model. We'll initiate, let's say we're in our automobile, we have an agent, we're on platform A. Let's go ahead and click. We'll pass control to our favorite grocery because we have a loyalty program with them, because they are focused and want to provide the best customer experience. They want me to operate within their brand experience, not to be disintermediated by someone else, not to have someone else control that experience, because they will want to control and engage with me in a private, data-protected way. That'll be passed, interoperable. And then we may go here and here and here and here and here, on and on and on. This is what we are building right now. We anticipate for perhaps these first three, keep an eye to GitHub, Open Voice Network. We will have first protocols and specifications draft to be tested And we have a number of companies lined up to test this and demo this in 4 to 6 to 8 weeks. By September 1, we anticipate there will be individuals, companies, firms, platforms testing this approach. Oita and I are reviewing the core white paper on that this weekend. Our team was going through some final development on that this past Tuesday. We're moving ahead and very rapidly. Future of conversational AI. Interoperable, data protected, secure. Here are the things we're also working on. Interoperability, of course, at the core. Then we're also working on how do you find and discover? Findability and discoverability. How can you, you're here, I want to go, anyone shop at Wegmans? Anyone know Wegmans food markets in the Northeast? Anyone shop at Target? Ever shop at Target? Send me to Target. How do I find Target in the United States in my neighborhood and not Target Australia? How do I find Delta Airlines and not Delta Faucet? How do I find and how do I discover? Is there a need for some kind of a destination registry or plan? Is there a need for some means of findability and discoverability? We believe yes in a worldwide voice web. How do you find Target? How do you find PayPal? And know and trust in an authenticated way that you have reached them. You have to know that is the place you want to go. Working on that. Oita leads our privacy, security, and ethical use portfolio. And she's going to talk about that in a moment. But at every step along the way, one will pass privacy controls, privacy understandings. One will pass data security protocols. And then certainly for those who are participating, companies will adopt the ethical use guidelines that we have published here recently, 1.0. This is where we're building to. And again, if you would, the prior slide, Oita, to this future. Trillions of destinations. Trillions of dollars, euros, whatever currency you wish in terms of total value in a worldwide voice web. I'm going to ask Oita to jump ahead to yet a next slide and turn it over to her about some of our work also. If you would, Oita, click that.
Are you going to mention the points at the top there? I think are really important. The bill once
please
use many. That whole Michelangelo moment that you were talking about, we are at the inflection point, similar where we were with the browser wars, with the independent platforms. Now is an enterprise, how do you write in this interoperability world once and not have to write specifically for the Alexa platform or for Siri. So this is the inflection point that we are when we say that Michelangelo moment. Bill wants use many places, and that's really the message behind interoperability that we're working towards.
One of the origin story of this happened in a December day in a Minneapolis meeting room. And it was about 2 degrees Fahrenheit outside. And I had been asked to make a presentation for 15 minutes to senior management of a major Fortune 500 firm in Minneapolis. And began talking 15 minutes. They said, prepare one slide. You know how difficult it is to prepare one slide, right? It's impossible. Prepare one slide. And the CIO, who I had the privilege of knowing was there, and began speaking about this voice thing. And he reached into his pocket, pulled out his smartphone, bing, 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 bing. And in 5 minutes, the CEO came in. Surprise. I had a flight in 90 minutes. I thought, well, that's okay. I can go home tomorrow. CEO came in. We began to discuss where this thing was going. And the CIO, again, this is a Fortune 500 firm. This is roughly $100 billion in revenue, Minneapolis, Minnesota. They said the following things. The CIO said, and to Oita's point, I need to build once and use everywhere. I'm not interested in investing in this platform, this platform, this platform, this platform. I want to build once. Maybe you feel the same way. The CEO said, I need to reach all my constituents. I don't care what platform they're on. I don't care what browser they use. I need to reach all of my constituents, all of my customers, all of my guests. And then finally, the CEO turned to the CIO, and they both turned to me, and the CEO said, well, wait a minute. Let's pause for a moment. Who owns the data? Because the data is where the money is. And the CIO said, well, currently, if you're working with one of the major platforms, those major platforms will claim your data. And the CEO said, and forgive my language, said, I'll be damned if anyone is going to take the data, which is the lifeblood of our business, reach all the constituents, build once, use many, and your data is yours, not theirs. And thank you, Oita, for reminding me to emphasize that three founding principles of the Open Voice Network, of which this vision of interoperability and the work we're doing to make that happen. Now, go ahead, if you would, Oita, thank you. I'm going to turn it to Oita. This is another reason why we're doing what we're doing, and critical for all of us to be thinking about, certainly those who are developing in voice and from the United Nations perspective. Oita, please.
So before I talk about this slide, I'm going to go back to this slide and echo the points about your data is yours, not theirs. In this scenario that you see here, it's about groceries and payment. But if you want to imagine, suppose it's about your health, your identity, things that are captured by your voice. And if you think about it, voice is the richest source of data outside of the human genome. So you're capturing text data, you're capturing acoustic, you're capturing context, and you're capturing all of those things around your voice data. And as the data is being analyzed, there's so much that can be learned about you. So going back to the question of who owns the data, who controls the data, and in the story of interoperability where data is shared from one agent to the next, who gets to see and know all of this information about you? Who gets to know your identity? Things like your name and related identity data, intent, questions that you ask of the voice agent. Behind that is analyzing, you know, what's the intent of your request. Physical characteristics, you know, we all know that based on our voice, you can probably tell I'm a short person. I, you know, my age, my weight, upper body strength. All those things can be learned. Ethnicity, our language, dialect. So just think as you go through each of these things, the more and more layers are known about you. Personality type, whether you're extrovert, introvert. Demographic information, where do you live? What's your educational level and what's your social status or in socioeconomic class even, based on your language, based on how you speak, sentiment, what's your emotional state, Are you angry? Are you depressed? Are you sad? You know, maybe they recommend if you're depressed, maybe we should go give you some ice cream. All of these things, you know, all these suggestions that are made, you know, would you like, you know, to seek help? All of these things are the intent and the information that's gathered about you. It is so personal. Trustworthiness and your physical health. Are you intoxicated? Thinking about this scenario where in that chart where there is so much with your automobiles now, where it's voice activated, and can you imagine a scenario where you have gone to a bar, knows your GPS information, it can analyze your voice, and based on that, determine whether you're intoxicated. All that information, you know, in the wrong hands can make, you know, can really be detrimental to you, to your personal safety, to your just who knows and has access to that information. And then mental health. All of those things are key to our work in helping to put in place guidelines related to privacy, related to security, related to ethical use. From a privacy standpoint, who has access? How do I give consent from agent to agent? How does that consent get passed from one agent to the next that I am authorizing this information to be passed? How do I control how much of that information is accessible to the initial agent versus the next? How do I get to delete the information? How do I understand the decisions that are made about the data in the background? All of those things, that's important to the work that we do from a privacy standpoint, from a in helping the you as a consumer understand from the ethical side the issues related to transparency. How do I know? How do I trust, you know, what's being done? What's the, you know, transparency and privacy, all of those things, and is it secure? The controls there. How do I trust that the authentication between one agent to the next, that I have the ability to, if they're using my voice, from to authenticate as an identifier, or if we say or start doing things like wallets where my voice is my passport. How do I trust that, and how is that authenticated? So all of those are things that we're working on in developing the privacy guidelines, security guidelines, and ethical guidelines that we've published and are working on.
This is, we're in a wild, wild west era of voice. We truly are. And the work of the Open Voice Network is to maybe not be the sheriff who walks in down the dusty center road, but certainly give some guidance to those who may be sheriffs and to be proposing ideas, concepts, standards, protocols, and the like to the great standards organizations worldwide. But as you look at this, just understand for a moment, and many of you who work in voice would know this, but right now, there are firms that are evaluating in real time the sentiment of shoppers. And then within, they promise and they say milliseconds, they are assigning different messages and different speakers, different call center agents to those. There are firms that are evaluating in real time Wall Street CFO quarterly statements. Is it believable or is it not? And sending that information in real time to Wall Street analyst firms, stocks going up, stocks going down, based upon trustworthiness. And then the use of biomarkers in physical health. A great story, a firm in outside Provo, Utah, Canary Speech, has a project going, and you're aware of the, some may use the term gypsy populations in the UK. I think they call themselves travelers. Well, they're not terribly interested in visiting doctors. They're not terribly interested in being part of a standard health community, but research has indicated that nearly all traveler families are equipped with smartphones. Canary Speech is working on a program with Northern Ireland Health that the diagnosis of some 15 to 20, even 30 seconds of that speech can give a sense of both physical and mental health of those communities. And especially at a time of COVID, are we hearing the raspiness in the voice? Are we hearing the coughing? Can you speak to me? And as a marvelous way, being tested right now, of how we use voice, acoustic analysis for some tremendous value creation within underserved populations. All kinds of things possible here. We can focus on the scary, we can focus on the good, it's all in front of us. The Open Voice Network working to bring this to the benefit of all. I think this is pretty much what we wanted to share with you. And I think Oita and I are gonna get silent and just listen to your questions and your comments and give you back some time, but please go ahead, Oita.
Do we want to touch on, I think one thing that's you might be interesting to touch on is the synthetic voice and the deep fakes, that additional work, because that is something that is also part of our work and is out as well.
You've all heard synthetic voice. You're all familiar with what that is, a cloned voice? Does that make sense? We could take, 30 minutes, 45 minutes of your voice, chop it up, reassemble it, and then have you speak a different language in your voice. One of the original and very prominent value propositions for this, Hollywood actors whose films go worldwide. Take, for example, Samuel L. Jackson. That's a voice that many of us would recognize immediately. Well, I was in Europe a couple weeks ago, and here was a Samuel L. Jackson film, and the voiceover in German was kind of like this, and it had a very high voice. And I thought, that's not Samuel L. Jackson. That made no sense. Well, now we can take Samuel L. Jackson's, cut it up, and have him speak Deutsch or speak Mandarin as only Samuel L. Jackson could do. And it begins to change all kinds of things in entertainment. But if you can do that, you could also take Joe Biden's voice or Donald Trump's voice and have that individual speak all kinds of interesting things.
Propaganda. There's so much.
It happens, and you know, we've seen that with Barack Obama and deepfakes and all kinds of things. One of the approaches to resolving that, potentially, is establishing some standards for audio watermarking. Is a means, without hearing a beep, that would identify when a synthetic voice is present, and then potentially a standard for consumer or enterprise detection of synthetic voice. We have a study group that has been meeting now for a year, just published a white paper, has a webinar on YouTube. What's synthetic voice? Where is it going? How might we address it? Again, the kind of work of the Open Voice Network. Here's the takeaway. Join our work. We are unique in that we start our meetings on time, but by golly, we always end on time. And if you say I have a hard stop at 10, you'll get a hard stop at 10. Our work groups, interoperability, privacy, data security, findability and discovery, ethical use, authentication, and I should have added synthetic voice. Those are the teams that we have working right now, meeting either weekly, biweekly, or monthly, and all of our documentation is in a Google workspace and increasingly on GitHub. You can just, as an individual, without committing your company, sign up as a friend of the Open Voice Network. You know, what you guys are doing is interesting. I'm interested in this. I support it. It's a good idea. You go on our website, click, I want to be a friend of the Open Voice Network. And if you're a friend, you're going to be involved and be invited to specific discovery meetings, specific overarching, I would say, here's what's going on, here's the inside look, here's the access to get, this is where we're looking on this and this and this. So friends are those who are going to know and see, be at the leading edge of what the Open Voice Network is doing. And then finally, as I mentioned, we have enterprise sponsors. We have companies that are on our board who are contributing monies. We're hiring third-party talent, people much smarter than me, equally as smart as Oita, to drive us forward, write the code, develop the protocols, establish the standards, develop, you know, the demos so we can test things to drive it forward. And there's multiple levels of sponsorship and gives and gets and the like. It's on our website. That's the Open Voice Network. That's what we're up to. And I think it's wonderful that we be quiet and let you tell your stories and ask your questions or ask for clarification. Please. Well, wait, anything else you want to add?
We would love to see you.
And thanks for your time.
And as John said, we are a judgment-free organization. Come as you as often or even if you want to sign up to be someone who, for our next, for example, review of our ethical guidelines, if you just would like to be serve as a reviewer, give us your feedback. Does this resonate within your enterprise? Is this something that, from the security guidelines perspective, is this something that your enterprise you think will adopt? And if not, what else needs to happen? What needs to be added? So, however you want to participate, attend meetings, or just be a friend, you know, a friend, you know, who can help advance the work that we're doing.
We're open, we're inclusive,
yes,
and we're guilt-free. You know, if you want to help in whatever way, you're absolutely welcome. So, yeah, questions, thoughts, yeah. Question was, I don't know if you heard it, was, okay, so you know, user owns your own data. Well, then where is that stored? Mm-hmm. How is that then used for training? What happens to the platform? Because the platform wants it for training and development. You know, we get that. And there's a value to that data. It's easy and the cliche to all to be determined. But I think one of the first things is, and this is what Oita and team have led, is an open consent. Do you understand who you're sharing your data with? Do you understand what's being shared? Do we even grasp that? That is a first step. So informed consent and a UX that makes that reasonably easy as opposed to something kludgy that takes you 14 years. So that's a first step. A second step would be, is it possible that I would have my own voice passport? Because I'm going to choose. Generally, I choose to share a lot of data because it's in my benefit to share. So I will choose to share with Amex. I've got a card. I want them to know. I choose to share with my retailers. I want them to know because I get things in return. So we're not suggesting that everyone locks their data away. It's much more users be aware, enterprises be aware. It's frightening the number of C-level people I meet with and Oita meets with who don't know in voice what's happening to their data. What do you mean? Well, yes, ma'am, yes, sir. This is what's happening. Kind of scary.
And we're also looking at, the first paper that we wrote was from the consumer, the user's perspective of privacy. And so we are now looking at, you know, the commercial enterprises care about privacy as well. So we're now creating a charter paper looking at the commercial privacy, because there right now, there are very few standards, guidelines from a...
Anything.
Related to commercial privacy. So we are, so your question is...
It's a great
is,
one.
...is very spot on.
Because I'm conversational AI space and from my sense, whatever you mentioned, we have phased like everything. That is the reason, whatever you mentioned, we have phased everything. So that is the reason we don't send data out.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
On a cloud, right.
Because we don't want to send data out because
right.
there's a proprietary issue. We don't trust third-party integrators. We had all the integration with Siri, Alexa, Google Voice, you name it, we had it. But that did not scale, because at the end of the day, you have to send the data.
Right.
That's not the right way to do it. So I understand all the concerns, but from your paper or the protocol perspective, how interconnected these things are. So the interoperability with privacy and data security. So is there like a mesh of connections across multiple things that they're trying to solve? Is it there yet, or is it just like protocol level where there will be a product that will follow? What is the current state right now?
Great question. What's the current state right now? We're at the early protocol level. So we're early in the process. And we realize back to the multiple end levels that you're describing, we've got to answer that and address that. And especially when privacy is going to be an informed consent, authentication. Is there an agreement as to data when we transfer, and that's happening in milliseconds, to be determined? And I hate to say, well, we don't know yet, but we're working toward that right now. We're at that stage. But your point is a great one.
And there was a part of your question, I believe you asked if we would be creating a product for that. What's that?
Yeah, so
yeah.
Protocol usually
yes.
I enforce that if you say,
right?
I cannot send anything that does not accept HTTPS.
Right.
So HTTPS
right.
is standard as a
right.
protocol.
Right.
But then they kind of evolved as a standard, and then they kind of integrated with the protocol. Right. So that's what I was thinking. Like, what is your vision towards it? Like, would you start with just one horizontal, like maybe interoperability,
mm-hmm.
and then evaluate it across multiple products? Because there are like tons of
yes.
products
yes.
right
yes.
now.
Yes.
That's the way we're thinking
world.
Right
yes.
now.
Yes. That
that's the way
world.
We're thinking
yes.
right now. Yeah, yeah. And we have a list of the first, seven or eight different platforms who have said, yeah, we want to work with you. And so we'll start working down that list. We are in conversation with some great friends at NVIDIA right now. Do you know Shyamala Prayaga at NVIDIA? But we know of that, Sarab, in terms of having developed with it, not yet. But we're aware of it, and thank you for mentioning that, because I'm registering that in my head for further follow-up. No, thank you.
You have a, yes.
This
back.
This one?
Okay.
Yeah, like who is the, and how would you define like who's the data steward, who's the data custodian, and like if you have any thoughts on that?
We are working to define that
mm-hmm.
right
yes.
now. This, the 0.1, and again, it may end up at a 0.2 something else. This is, if you will, the, you use very precise terms, and I love those. This is the custodian and owner that will make a informed decision to share some level of this. If we have n number of layers, it could be just text, or it could be text acoustic and then bing, 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 bing to share here. And then this accepts and says, I am now the custodian. Or I'm a delegate of that. The custodian ownership is here, and I'm simply sharing a bit of this to obtain information, add Pinot Noir to my shopping list. Bing, okay, back. So there will be some contextual difference, but that's the one, that's the zero dot, it's probably 0.001 right now in thinking, if that makes sense, if that helps.
Yeah, and also with the question that you asked, the terms you were using, was they have similar terms within the GDPR, EDPB, so those terms, and so as a global organization, we need to be very aware of those roles and how they are defined, and especially there's a data act that is underway that even further defines those roles and what's required, and as that data is passed and the delegates, it does spell that out. So we are very aware of those things and making sure that whatever guidelines we come up with are fall in line from a global perspective.
Yeah.
So, very good question.
Yeah.
There are two questions that came in virtually, so I'm going to read them to you to answer. The first is, one of the scary possibilities that could come from this sort of data getting into the wrong hands is, and I'm thinking Facebook non-user profiles, GDPR situation, is how through data banks someone could easily come up with, using image clouds, fake 3D versions of everyone with a voice and all. We all speak into our phones or around our phones, and that could easily turn against us. What are your thoughts on this?
The answer is we agree with a concern. Yes, we have not yet addressed that specific issue and question, but it falls broadly into the reasons why we have been pursuing, and Oita is finishing the final draft of our paper on data security specific to voice. What are the new issues that voice brings? How do we even think about them? What are the next steps that a worldwide voice web will bring to us? In a world of interoperability, security becomes, now we have new threat surfaces, et cetera. But to, again, the statement, thank you, it's one that we'll want to capture and add to the list. Thank you. Are we at anything else?
No. There was a second question?
Yes. And then someone else asked, they said, great topic. Are there groups that work on voice-to-text apps? Any prereqs to join in for development? Are they happening in real time? And speech therapy-related applications? Mm-hmm. Question mark.
I should have mentioned we have several industry-focused groups. And please, if you... whoever asked the question, please know that we have a health, wellness, and life sciences group that is right now working on the role of voice in remote patient monitoring and management, of which speech therapy and the use of voice would be a part. We've had some conversations with a wonderful center that works with multiple sclerosis and cystic fibrosis patients in Birmingham, Alabama, for the use of voice technologies in therapy, creation of synthetic voices to give those patients a voice, and ongoing therapies, I think I said that. And would love to learn more of your interests, the individual who asked the question, and potentially bring you into some of our conversations on the RPM and M topic. Thank you. Thanks for your time. Thanks, especially here late in the day. Thank you.
I had a small question, just because I was curious. I have a friend who's really interested in environmental things going on in computer vision and more on the acoustic side of things. Mm-hmm. So do y'all have anything going on there for like bioacoustics or anything?
From the ethical side or from the...
Help us understand. Help us understand more.
General question, if y'all had anything on the acoustic side for the environment or like
not specifically at this point.
Sorry, I know,
but
it's very vague.
No.
Not specifically.
I'd like to learn more.
No, I'd love to learn more.
More. Yes, yeah. Definitely would like yeah. to learn more.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So much.
Yes.
So what are we doing? So we are starting the
Thank you.